N'hésitez pas à vous mettre derrière le micro pour pouvoir poser vos questions. Feel free to line up behind the mic to ask your questions.
Il n'y a pas vraiment de choses bizarres ou particulières qu'on lui demandait de faire. Elle dit oui, c'est déjà arrivé qu'on me demande de faire des trucs en convention ou quoi, mais par contre si ça m'embarrasse, je refuse de le faire. Elle dit après, dans la série, il n'y a pas eu de truc en particulier. Elle dit déjà, la série en elle-même était particulière. Elle dit, et mon personnage était drôle et complètement foufou. Donc à chaque fois qu'on me donnait le script et qu'on me disait qu'il fallait que je fasse ça, je disais, yes, bon, je vais le faire.
Thank you.
Ouais.
Invisalign braces.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Cut that. Sorry. Please don't take a picture of me.
S'il vous plaît, prenez pas de photos pendant que je suis en train de me remettre l'appareil.
My mouth is, if I'm speaking funny, it's because the Invisalign is it. It makes me sound like a lift all the time.
Si elle parle chelou aussi, c'est normal, c'est le...
Like I'm 12, again.
J'ai eu comme si j'avais 12 ans avec un truc pour faire des notes de vous.
Hello Emma. Yesterday you were not really able to answer my question because Nick was being Nick. So I'm going to ask it again because it seems that we wouldn't have a really interesting answer to it. How was it be to be on Buffy one day on set and to be in the middle of this crazy show? And you were talking about people being around you saying, oh, you're great, again and again and again, and we're going to elaborate on that, so I'd like to have more about it. One day on set on Buffy and how it was to be in the middle of this crazy show.
I'm sorry, what was it like being in the midst of that show?
In the middle, yeah, of the show, and one day on set, yesterday I asked you, what was one day on set looks like? And you said, you have a lot of people going at me saying, oh, you're great, you're wonderful, and you are talking about ego and being...
Oh my God, what did I say? I have no idea what you're talking about.
I can help you.
I was also in so much pain yesterday. What was I saying?
Okay,
so it sounds like I was saying something super smart, but I don't know.
You did.
I don't know what I was saying.
So basically, his question has two parts. The first one is if you can tell us what was it like a regular day on set.
A regular day.
A regular day on set. And the second part, to be part of that big show and be part of to be a big part of it. And at a certain point, but you couldn't finish your answer.
Yeah.
You were saying that something that was kind of weird or that is a good feeling, but it puts you in a certain position is all day long you have people saying that you're great, that you're good, what you do is amazing and everything. And at some point, it's like you end up believing in it, and so it fills your ego and your pride, but it has a
negative
consequence. But
yes.
You didn't have the chance to finish that or to tell us a regular day.
Okay, well, a regular day was always very long, so you know, about 12 hours was a short day. That was like a good day. They were typically much longer than that, especially if you had prosthetics. If you had prosthetics, the makeup, like the monster makeup, you know, then you have to come in way early because that would take 2 to 3 hours to do. Luckily, I didn't have to do that often, so I was winning. So they were long, but fun. Generally speaking, they were just fun. You know, that's really when, you know, I don't know, the crew is really great. We all laughed a lot. Just, yeah, kind of crazy long. We've got, you know, by the end of the 10 months of shooting, we're all just done, like super just exhausted and ready to like go into like a 3 month coma. So every day was, you know, yeah, just fun. I mean, I'm trying to find a way to elaborate on fun, but that really is just how it was. It was just fun, long, tiring, and fun. And as far as this very interesting point I attempted to make yesterday, I'm trying to get back into that frame of mind, but I think probably what I was trying to say was that, you know, you start out in a kind of a bubble, and you don't really know how things are being perceived, and then you start to get a rhythm, and then you hear that, you know, the show is being well received and that it's respected, and you're like, oh, okay, and you start feeling really good about yourself, and then you. And then it's over. And so I think that's kind of with any job that sends somebody to sort of a long-term job, or it can really apply to any job. It's gonna be hard for you, I'm sorry. But not to, what the hell kind of point was I trying to make to you yesterday? I think it was just to not believe your own hype, I guess. That when you're part of something that's really that well respected, you can, you feel
kind
like
you're
just too cool for school, you know, and it's a definitely, you know, not all projects are like that, so you're looking for that validation again, because once you taste that validation, it can be, that's nice, it's good to feel like you're really well respected by your peers and by critics, and that Those just really don't come around that often. You might be involved in something popular, but maybe critics don't like it, or maybe you're part of something the critics like, but no one sees it. You know, that little mix. It's rare, and that was a good feeling. I think what I was trying to say was it was a fun time to be a part of that, and then to kind of a downer to have it done and then seeking that again, as opposed to just seeking something that you like or that I liked, as opposed to trying to attach all the other things to it.
And to manage to stay down to hers.
Yeah, I mean, I think I... I think I stayed younger. I think you know, you just, or at least for me now, I appreciate things a lot more now than I did back then. I just appreciate things a lot more now. I think, yeah, mais on a absolutely with that.
Sur une journée typique de ton âge, déjà une journée de 12 heures, c'était une journée courte. Voilà, c'était la journée de base, de partie 12 heures. Beaucoup de journées étaient beaucoup plus longues que ça. Elle dit, et ça, c'est sur les journées où on n'avait pas de maquillage. Elle dit, parce que dès qu'il fallait mettre les prothèses, les masques, les machins, les trucs, là déjà, t'en as pour 2 à 3 heures minimum de maquillage. Elle dit, donc c'était épuisant. Crevant, mais c'était fun, c'était cool. Alors c'est difficile de définir le concept de fun, mais on riait pas mal entre nous, etc. Elle dit après, il faut imaginer que c'est sur 10 mois à travailler, donc plus de 12 heures par jour. Elle dit clairement, à la fin de chaque saison, on avait 2-3 mois, on avait envie de tomber dans le coma, et on tombait dans le coma pour se remettre et repartir à bosser. Quant à ce qu'elle essayait de dire hier sur le fait de faire partie d'une série comme ça, elle dit en fait au départ t'es plongé dans une bulle et cette bulle tu te rends pas encore compte de l'impact de ce que ça va provoquer de ce que ça provoque autour. Elle dit et c'est aussi une chance d'être sur une série qui a été acclamée par les critiques, qui a été acclamée par le public. Elle dit, et effectivement, ça te met bien, forcément, ça flatte ton ego, et tu te sens bien de faire partie de ça. Elle dit, effectivement, là où ça peut poser problème, c'est que derrière, tu vas constamment être dans la recherche d'être sur des séries qui sont, ou des projets qui sont à ce niveau-là, qui sont là-haut, sauf que des fois, tu vas avoir des trucs, la critique va adorer, et par contre, personne ne va regarder. Des fois, c'est le public qui va adorer et la critique va massacrer le projet. Elle dit, et c'est d'arriver aussi à un moment de se satisfaire de ce qu'on a et pas être dans l'attente, pas être dans l'expectative de recommencer toujours à vouloir être tout le temps au même niveau. Elle dit, et, par exemple, aujourd'hui, elle apprécie beaucoup plus ce qu'elle a maintenant qu'à l'époque. À l'époque, il n'y avait pas encore cette réalité-là, justement par rapport à tout ce qu'elle expliquait, où t'es dans une bulle sur un truc, sur une machine qui est monstrueuse. Et forcément, dans la vie, t'as pas constamment une machine monstrueuse qui est là.
Next up, I'm just going to be very short.
Sorry, Rodolphe, I've got a question for Emma, but she said she's going to be short, so it's good for you. What do you think about the arc of your character and what she's been through and the end of her death? How she died?
I thought her arc was beautiful. And as far as her death goes, I asked to die, so I mean, I wasn't surprised by that. I get asked, well, why would you ask for that? Well, why was that important to you or anything? And I just felt like her whole journey throughout the series was to find her humanity or to understand humanity. And I felt like with her giving up her life to save her friends, ultimately humanity, that was the ultimate sacrifice she could make. And there was something very poetic about that, so it was very could have had a little bit more of characters could have been a little sadder about it, but what are you gonna do? Can't have anything.
Elle a adoré l'évolution et l'art de son personnage tout au long de la série et par rapport à sa mort. Elle dit en fait c'est Emma qui a demandé à tuer Alia. Elle dit parce que pour elle, l'évolution du personnage, c'est qu'elle trouve son humanité. C'est qu'elle la découvre, qu'elle la trouve enfin. Et au final, de mourir en se battant pour défendre tout le monde, elle a fait le sacrifice ultime qui prouve son humanité. Donc du coup, pour elle, c'était la fin de son voyage, c'était la fin de son parcours de vie, et elle est très contente de ça. Ça aurait été bien aussi qu'on voit un peu plus les autres qui soient attristés par sa mort. Mais bon, c'est ce qu'on lui fasse.
Thank you. Two small questions, one for Emma and one for the two of you. So I begin with the one for Emma. I'm sorry, Buffy fans, but I need to ask, I don't know if I will meet her again because I'm a answer. So what was it like to play the blind witch in Once Upon a Time?
I love her so much. She was incredible. I can't say enough good things about that. She was just this ridiculous character. I don't know, there's something super perverse about enjoying playing someone who wanted to eat kids, but she was awesome. It was a joy, like, through and through.
Comment c'était de jouer la sorcière dans Once Upon a Time? Elle dit, j'ai adoré ce personnage. Vraiment, j'ai adoré. C'était juste de jouer un personnage aussi ouf. Elle dit, il y a un petit truc un peu pervers, hein, dans le fait d'aimer jouer un personnage qui aime manger les enfants, d'accord. Elle dit, mais j'aurais pas assez de mots pour dire à quel point j'ai aimé.
What do you like the most to develop in your character? What is the best part of your character?
For me, it's just logic. I can't stand it when I don't understand something. So I have to have my own logic. Okay. That's what I like to develop. Like, if that's not there, it's very, very difficult for me. And I want to look good too.
Comment ils développent leur personnage. Rudolph disait, moi j'ai besoin de la logique en fait. J'ai besoin de comprendre le personnage qui se passe et comment le faire. Si j'ai pas la logique, j'y arrive pas. Donc je développe ma propre logique. Il dit, et puis je veux quand même être beau.
In that character, or in any character?
As Anya?
Yes.
Not as Anya.
Gosh. I don't know. I mean, I think just keeping her from becoming. No, that's actually not true. I was going to say something, but I don't know. Actually, to keep her relatable, I think, you know, to relatable. I mean, she ultimately is very, I think, relatable because she was so honest and, you know, she was the truth teller, but in that way. So people who appreciate the truth obviously would appreciate her, but, you know, keeping that from becoming like its own punchline. Keeping her still human throughout, I think, which I was always trying to keep, make sure I was with her on that part, always. Like keeping her really well-rounded while being this sort of, she was a joke. I mean, she was constantly, she wasn't setting up jokes, but she was always very funny. Every time she spoke was something ridiculous. So to keep a balance in that and not just be one note. You know?
Just for sure, I know.
Yeah.
That was not just the group director, but also the
undercurrent of all that. Like to make sure that checked, like her development underneath. Sort of bluntness, like keeping that, you know, to have that progress naturally and just to always have a little bit of that discomfort show.
Qu'en fait, sur le développement, qu'on puisse continuer à pouvoir petit à petit s'identifier quand même au personnage, parce que clairement, c'est peut-être le personnage le plus comique de la série, parce qu'elle est tellement vraie, elle a quand même des punchlines qui sont improbables. Eddie, mais qu'elle continue, parce que c'est, on s'attache aussi à elle, parce que c'est elle qui dit la vérité. C'est elle qui balance toujours, même les trucs qu'on n'a pas envie d'entendre, que des gens vont penser mais qui n'osent pas dire, c'est Anya qui les balance. Mais en même temps, tout en gardant ce côté, elle est frontale et elle balance tout, mais en même temps, on voit l'évolution chez elle de son humanité. Et de continuer à la faire grandir, tout en gardant son niveau, son caractère à elle. And would you have liked for you, would you have liked that we see more of Dracula? And what would you do? Whoa!
I would love to see more Dracula. I loved what you did. Loved it.
Well, thank you.
From what I remember, the first half of the episode, it looked like it could have gone. So, but in the way maybe he finished, he can't bring it back. It's kind of ridiculous at the end. It was so easy to kill. But the way it was built up, yeah, he could have done something more prolonged, because he was, what it was really about was her, it was Buffy, and he was trying to get that darkness that she had, but she wasn't conscious of, that she was fighting. And that could have been something very interesting to make her character more complex. So this Dracula probably could have stuck around a little bit to delve deeper into Buffy's dark subconscious. And I would have liked to have done that, yes, sure.
J'aurais bien aimé pouvoir en faire plus avec le personnage de Dracula. Il dit après, quand tu regardes la première moitié de l'épisode, tu te dis que ouais, il y a moyen que Dracula il reste. Il dit, quand tu vois la fin de l'épisode et comment Dracula il s'en débarrasse, c'est tellement ridicule, c'était pas possible qu'il le fasse revenir. Alors le mec, casse-toi. Donc c'était pas possible. Il dit, mais par contre, il met bien ce côté où clairement Dracula, ce qui l'intéresse, c'est Buffy, et qu'il ait accès, lui, à cette part d'ombre qui est en elle, et lui, il arrive à avoir accès à ça. Il dit, je pense que ça aurait pu être intéressant pour le personnage, et que Dracula reste, pour aller plus loin et creuser beaucoup plus profondément dans ces parts d'ombre dont elle n'a même pas conscience au départ.
Thank you very much.
Question for Rudolf, but you pretty much answered the just before. It was how was it to play the big boss of the vampires? Mm. And for Emma, my question was, how did you react when you found out that the phobia of your character was the rabbits?
Well, I mean, I laughed, obviously. It was ridiculous. I mean, every script was hysterical from my perspective, just because she was ridiculous. And of course, she would be afraid of mummies. Like, it's just ridiculous. It's perfect, perfect for her. I never thought that it would take on its own life. In many ways, I think that character quirk is bigger than the character herself. I think there's so many great things about the character that at times it seems sort of like shortchange her to make it like, and she is bummies, you know. I mean, I can see why, because it's so emblematic, but it does that character just a little bit of a disservice to just have it kind of always come back to that, because there was so many other, if not more ridiculous things about that character and that you found out about her. Who doesn't want bunnies?
Sur la phobie d'Anya pour les lapins, elle dit comment t'as réagi quand t'as découvert ça? Elle dit, moi j'étais éclaté. Enfin, elle dit, je vois ça. Elle dit, parce que c'est logique que la phobie des lapins, c'est une phobie limite qui est tellement ridicule. Ridicule, pas que dans le sens où on se moque d'eux, mais c'est trop gros, c'est énorme, quoi. Elle dit, et de toute manière, Anya, pour le coup, sa phobie des lapins, ça a carrément pris vie seule, ce truc-là, parce que ça revient même dans plusieurs épisodes. Elle dit c'est comme si ça avait pris une part à part entière du personnage et même une importance que tout le monde le sait, tout le monde le retient. Elle dit mais il y a tellement de choses qui sont énormes ou ridicules à propos de ce personnage. À chaque fois qu'elle recevait un script, elle était morte de rire parce que y a quelqu'un qui peut avoir peur des lapins. Tout le monde aime les lapins, c'est trop mignon un lapin. Mais pas pour rien. Et c'est cette construction du ridicule autour d'elle.
Thank you. And I wanted also to tell you that I love you in Tiger, the movie.
Oh, thank you. I love Tiger.
Yes, I love it too.
Did you like the way it ended?
It's special, yeah, but the concept is great, isn't it?
I love it. So, yeah.
Your characters were a little bit, I guess, disconnected at times from what we sort of already had ideas about in the show. Anya was very funny, particularly in moments where it could be quite somber and quite dark. Dracula as well, when it came along, we had this idea about what vampires were and the relationship with Buffy. You came along and were quite sort of elegant, and you had this real connection with Buffy that other vampires didn't have. So my question is, how did you sort of approach that uniqueness in your characters? Quite different to what else was going on.
Okay, for me, we just talked about it in the room briefly, but so for me, the challenge was I had just finished a movie, Vlad the Impaler, where I played the real Dracula. So for me, the challenge was number one, how do I make this one different? Because it's a different genre and something that works for the show. And still use some of that I have in me from having played the real guy. And the other thing was I had a lot of history with Sarah Michelle Gellar, Buffy, because we had worked together, we had been a couple on a soap opera for two years. And to also use that dynamic with her. And in the end, I didn't really know how to do any of that, so I just decided to just trust that that's there, because those are things that are in me that I can't just shape, and just try to focus on the, you know, the scenes and have fun with it, and let the writing and the other preparation that has been done do its magic, and so that was my challenge. It's really to make it different from the other Dracula, and what's really there with Sarah, which is, you know, always a gift for an actor when you have pre-existing chemistry that you can use.
You played the movie as a real...
With Vlad the Impaler in the same year, yeah, a few months before that, in Romania.
Par rapport au côté unique chacun de leurs personnages, par rapport à tous les autres, où ils ont des trucs beaucoup plus communs, comment est-ce qu'ils ont arboré la création de leur perso? Il dit, ben, pour Rudolph, ce qui était compliqué, entre guillemets, c'est qu'il venait juste de finir un film dans lequel il jouait le comte Vladimir, le vrai, celui qui a vraiment existé, qu'après on va surnommer le vampire. Et donc c'était comment passer de ce film où il a interprété le vrai à devoir faire la série et l'interpréter complètement différemment, puisque c'est un autre genre, c'est une autre vision de la chose. Et ensuite, il a quand même une histoire avec Sarah Michelle Gellar, puisque pendant 2 ans, ils ont joué ensemble un couple dans un soap opera. Et du coup, c'était de essayer d'utiliser un peu cette alchimie qu'ils avaient quand ils ont joué ensemble pendant 2 ans pour le remettre. Et puis finalement, quand je suis arrivé, tout effacé, parce que ça ne pouvait pas marcher de cette manière-là. Et donc, on a fait un reboot. Et je me suis dit. Ok, je vais faire confiance à l'écriture du scénario, au script et à la préparation qu'on a eue avant, et je vais laisser faire.
I never approached playing her at any point differently. you know, I always just approached Anya as I did. The fact that the show grew darker, I suppose the only thing that I was cognizant of was just how aware of was probably how, I guess, how much more her humor punched against the darkness that was happening. You know, it hit harder. And reading the scripts, they got very dark, awesome, but dark. So, you know, whenever I got to say anything funny, it's like, oh, phew, just a little bit of levity. But as far as how, you know, how I approached it, it was always the same.
Tout au long des saisons, en fait, Emma, elle a jamais abordé le personnage de Anya différemment. Elle l'a toujours abordé de la même manière, sur le même niveau. Elle dit, et même si au fur et à mesure la série, elle a évolué de manière de plus en plus sombre sombre et violente, elle dit, l'avantage d'Anya, c'est que c'est elle qui avait toujours les punchlines, encore une fois, enfin les tons sarcastiques et d'humour qui allaient complètement à l'encontre de la violence des épisodes. Elle dit donc du coup, elle a toujours pu l'approcher de la même manière, sans changement.
Thank you. And there's a question. So we can all go to eat.
Lunch.
Yeah, that's the lunch break.
Dernière question, je vous demande de faire un tonnerre d'applaudissements. Avec du bruit et tout.